Hello, and welcome to Unity as a Library. Insert Unity-powered features directly into your app. My name's Dan Miller, and I'm a senior developer advocate focused on XR, which mostly means that I focus on augmented and virtual reality content. Today, I'm going to be talking about Unity as a Library, and I'll be sure to highlight some different features and how you can enable augmented reality inside your app. And when we talk about apps, we're really talking about native applications here, initially on iOS and Android, but we've also expanded it to native Windows apps as well. With the power of Unity, you're able to add augmented reality, 2D, 3D, real-time features and rendering, and more. This can really add another layer of depth, as well as enable all the different tools and features we have in Unity directly into a native app. Let's go over the agenda. First, we'll talk a little bit about what is Unity as a library. Next, we'll dive into getting started with Unity. And today, we're mostly just going to be focused on the mobile side. First, highlighting integration with iOS, then integration with Android. Finally, we'll end with some things to consider, as well as some additional links where you can find out more, as well as get access to some sample projects. Let's talk a little bit about what is Unity as a library. At its core, it's the ability to bundle Unity and reference it in native platforms as a library. It's currently supported on iOS, Android, Windows, and the Universal Windows platform. A key feature is being able to pass data between Unity and the native app. On the Unity side, you communicate with native applications or native APIs just as you would during any other app development. On the native side, you're able to pass in and feed data to Unity using some built-in and custom APIs that we've enabled when linking Unity through a library. Some limitations and things to consider. Currently, Unity as a library is only supported for full screen rendering on mobile. This means that your application will take up the entire screen. Also, you can only load one instance of Unity at a time. Now, Unity does support things like multi-scene, and you can bundle and load that up together, but keep it in mind that you can only ever have one instance of Unity loaded as a library in an app at a time. And lastly, when Unity is in an unloaded state, after calling application.unload, it does retain a little bit of memory, and that's something to keep in mind as you continue to load or unload Unity and consider the app flow and how it works linking in Unity as a library. Now let's go ahead and start talking about getting started with Unity and enabling your project to build as a native application and be referenced as a library. I'm not going to cover the specifics of setting up different build environments, since we've already added the specific modules, as well as enabled the development environment here for native development. Here, we're just going to be focusing on the different settings that you'll be adjusting with Unity. On the Android side, you'll want to enable the checkbox here in the build settings that allows Unity to export as a Gradle project. This is what you'll be linking into your native Android application once it's built and compiled. Here, we're naming the project Android Build and putting it inside the Unity project. This is something to keep in mind as we'll be using some of these file paths to directly link in the Android build inside our native Android application. Here we are inside Android Studio. We've loaded up a native Android app. The first thing we need to do is adjust a couple of the settings on the Gradle scripts in order to properly link in our pre-built Unity Android Gradle project. First, we'll go to the settings.gradle file. Here, we're going to include Unity library, as well as the project Unity library, passing in the project directory to the file path. Next, we'll open the build.gradle module. Here, we're going to add some additional dependencies in the first upper block. First, the implementation project Unity library. Next, the implementation file tree, which again has the directory, the project Unity library, and passing in the libs folder to include the jar file types. Finally, we've opened up the build.gradle project. Next, we'll add a directory to the repositories. Here, we're adding the Unity library and then the project directory /libs. Finally, we'll hit the sync button, which will then sync all our additional Gradle script changes and allow us to build and compile this application. Here you can see the native application that we've built. There's two buttons for showing Unity and finishing. When clicking the Show Unity button, you'll see an instance of Unity launch. Here we can see the default Unity splash screen and now some additional buttons, both on the native side as well as within the Unity application itself. Notice how the application is running full screen. We can select different buttons to change the color of the cube, as well as send a message back to the native side using the Send Message button. We can also unload the application, which allows us to reinitialize or reload Unity. And here's the different functionality available in this default Unity as a Library example app. Next, I want to briefly talk about the interop and communicating with a native app inside of Unity. First, you'll need to put your native files directly in the plugins folder within the assets directory. Here you can see we have one for iOS as well as Android. On the Android side, we have a override Unity activity Java file. Here in the Java file, you can see that we have a reference to the override Unity activity instance, as well as some abstract protected methods for update Unity shop item and item placed in AR. Here we also have some overrides for the protected void onCreate as well as onDestroy methods. This script is pulled from the AR sample for Unity as a library. On the C# side, here we are in our Product Manager class. Within the onPlaced method, we have a try-catch block here that's if defed for Unity Android specifically. Here, we're getting a reference to that override activity Android Java class, then getting a reference to the instance. Next, we use the override activity.call method and pass in the method name, in this case, item placed in AR. Next, in the catch, we catch the exception and log an error if an exception occurs. Similarly, in the update shop item method, we have another ifdef Android block and another try catch. Doing a similar call here to get the Android Java class, overriding the activity, and using overrideActivity.call for update Unity shop item. And finally, catching the exception and logging the error. Now let's shift focus a bit and talk about iOS. First, we'll start off similarly building the Xcode project inside the Unity project. Here, we'll open up a native iOS project and create what we call a workspace. We'll name that workspace both, and we'll add the native iOS project as well as the built Unity project to that workspace. Next, on the native iOS app, we'll go to the general settings and the frameworks, library, and embedded content. Here we can hit the plus button and add the Unity framework. Next, we'll go to the build phases, and under the link binary with libraries, we'll actually remove the Unity framework.framework. Finally, we'll hop into the Unity project and adjust some settings on the target membership of a couple files. Here, we'll first select the native call proxy.h. These are the files that we put in our plugins folder when building this Unity app. We'll want to make sure that the target membership is the Unity framework and that it's set to public. Next, we can select the data folder. We'll also want to make sure this target membership is on Unity Framework if it's not already selected. We'll also want to uncheck Unity-iPhone, so just the Unity framework is in the target membership of the data folder. Next, if we've correctly signed both applications and projects, we should be able to select the target device. Now we can build and run this native project, linking in Unity as a library on iOS. Let's take a look at how to interop between native code in Unity and the iOS platform. Here we have a header file that we start off by first defining a protocol, as well as our required methods for the update Unity shop item and item placed in AR. Finally, we have an interface at the bottom to register API for native calls. Here in the implementation file, you see we have the ID for the API, as well as the definitions for registering the API calls and the extern C for the update Unity shop items and item placed in AR. Here in C#, we first need to make sure that we're using the system runtime interop services namespace. Here we've ifdefed it, so it's only included for iOS. We also have a public class for native API, where we use the DLL import attribute and define the public static extern void methods for the update Unity shop item and the item placed in AR. Finally, at the bottom, we have else if defed for Unity iOS, and here we're simply calling native API.itemPlacedInAR. And in the next method, update shop item, similar if defed or else if defed, native API.unity.updateUnityShopItem. When getting started with iOS, there's a couple things to consider. Right now, this is only supported on Xcode 9.4. When thinking about Unity, we suggest using the latest LTS or the latest stable release, so 2019.4 or 2020.1. Now let's talk about some of the requirements for Android. Here we have, again, some requirements for the Android Studio version, 3.4.2, and similarly recommend using the Unity LTS 2019.4. A couple things to consider when developing Unity as a library is how complex your Unity application is. If you're using lots of third-party or native plugins, you might have to adapt them, both native and managed, to work with the Unity runtime. Lastly, I wanted to end with a couple sample applications. Here we have a Unity as a library example, just a base implementation. It has some documentation for the different steps of linking Unity as a library for both iOS and Android, and has a sample app that's built on the native platforms for both iOS and Android as well. Next is the UAAL, or Unity as a Library AR example. This is a bit more complex example that allows the user to interface with a native application for shopping and then visualize products in augmented reality. Here you can select different colors, do some customizations, and transfer data and information from the native side back to the Unity side. Thank you for attending this Unite Now session about Unity as a library. I hope you've learned a lot and helped build your Unity skills and advance your projects. Finally, be sure to check out the Unite Now page for other sessions that are sure to inform and inspire you.